Good afternoon and welcome to the third of the History Reflected Behind Closed Doors online curator talks, and a special welcome to our Sydney Living Museum's members and supporters. This talk is titled Constructing a Life in the Colony. My name is Dr. Penny Stannard and I'm the head of curatorial at Sydney Living Museums and New South Wales State Archives. I'd like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land where I'm broadcasting from at home today, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, and I pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging, and to all First Nations people joining us today. History Reflected is a new exhibition produced especially for the Museum of Sydney to mark the partnership between New South Wales State Archives and Sydney Living Museums, two of Australia's most significant cultural collections. History Reflected presents a selection of 25 items from the New South Wales State Archives collection, spanning 213 years from 1787 to the year 2000. Some of the items are the collection's most curious, iconic, and important items. As the Museum of Sydney is closed due to the New South Wales COVID-19 lockdown situation, our audiences can't yet enjoy the exhibition in person. So we've created this series of online talks to connect with you until we can meet you when the Museum of Sydney opens its doors. Each Thursday at 4 p.m, zoom in on this channel and enjoy hearing different curators talk about their work on the exhibition and their discoveries. At the end, there'll be time to ask questions. Last Thursday, historian Jane Kelso spoke about the 1828 New South Wales census, a record that deals with our state's population 193 years ago. Today, curator Dr. Jackie Newling will present an account of one ordinary man's life, Joseph Milsom, in the colony. Dr. Jackie Newling specialises in place-based social history and heritage, connecting the past with the present and bringing meaningful stories to contemporary audiences through various forms of media, from exhibitions to interpretive opportunities for visitors in Sydney Living Museums. Jackie's curatorial and interpretation roles at Sydney Living Museums, Museum of Sydney, Hyde Park Barracks, and extensive First Fleet research for her PhD have honed her interest in our convict history and its legacies. The convict story she's unearthed from the New South Wales State Archives collection through her research for History Reflected has made her very excited. Who knew such an ordinary man could have such a lasting presence in Sydney today? Now it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Jackie Newling to present Constructing a Life in the Colony.
Thank you, Penny, and thank you everyone who has joined us today. I'm speaking to you from Wangal country and acknowledge Australia's First Nations people as rightful owners of the land we occupy and call home. I pay my respects to elders past and present and any First Nations community members listening in. I'd also like to thank Emily, Hannah and the team at State Archives who have sourced the material I'm sharing with you today and that I found so useful and enlightening. I'm going to share my screen but also turn off my camera to save bandwidth, and hopefully I can do all that very smoothly. On display in the exhibition are three documents relating to Joseph Milsom, who was convicted of highway robbery in 1823 and sentenced to transportation for life to New South Wales. He arrived in the colony aboard the Guildford in 1824. You see here Milsom's ticket of leave and matching butt from 1838. And you can see that the two pieces were once attached. Similar to the system of parole today, the ticket of leave permitted a convict to live, work and earn an income in the community, albeit within a specified district. To keep the ticket of leave, you had to maintain good conduct and report regularly to local authorities. Tickets of leave are relatively rare in the archive, as they were carried by the recipient at all times to prove their identity and status. This is Milsom's second ticket of leave, probably because the original ticket, issued in 1833, was damaged or worn out. The but was kept in a ledger as the government record. Also on display in the exhibition is the government's copy of his conditional pardon, dated January 1842. The conditional caveat was that he was not permitted to return to England, but Milsom could now live out his days as a free person in Australia. These items capture key moments in Milsom's journey from convict to free. His story is just one of many represented in the 140,000 convict-related records in the State Archives collection. Some 80,000 men and women arrived in New South Wales as convicts between 1788 and 1842. Most came from Britain and Ireland, and their sentences ranged from 7 or 14 years to life. On the reverse side of the ticket butt and of the pardon are details of Milsom's sentence and personal profile. We learn from them that Milsom was a stonecutter. Born in 1805, he was about 18 years old when he was sentenced. He was 5'7", with dark hair and eyes. He supported a scar on his right cheek and had several tattoos, a heart, a man, and two other markings on his right arm, a child, the letter GM and IM, perhaps initials of relatives, and an anchor on the back of his lower left arm, a J on the inside of his left arm and JM on the back of his left hand. He'd be readily identified in a lineup with this kind of detail on the record. But the ticket of leave and conditional pardon are only two examples of the incremental steps this convict took to construct a life in the colony and find eventual freedom from servitude. The State Archives contains records of when people intersect with government. During his time as a convict, Joseph Milsom came to the government's attention more often than most. On face value, when first presented with Milsom's record, it seemed to me he was a recidivist. He was sent to the Port Macquarie Penal Settlement in 1825, a place of secondary punishment for prisoners who performed further crimes during their sentences. He also spent 2 years on Norfolk Island in 1830 and 31. Norfolk was another place of harsh secondary punishment, but surprisingly, Milsom was granted a ticket of leave in 1833. By then he'd completed 10 years of his sentence, so perhaps he'd earned his due. Milsom applied for a conditional pardon in 1837, but it was refused, and the following year he faced trial again for a violent altercation involving a police constable. Here was a man that couldn't keep out of trouble. But I was yet to visit the State Archives and properly review Milsom's files. Thanks to Emily's expert tracing skills, because his name is spelt in various different ways, the archive produced 4 bundles of papers in addition to the ticket of leave butts and pardons registers. They contain far more information than I had anticipated. Instead of a serial criminal, I found a man caught in the system, making every effort he could, except for a couple of misdemeanors, to better his life and eventually free himself of his convict sentence. It was like a game of snakes and ladders, glimmers of hope after a few steps forward, interspersed with setbacks as he navigated the colonial bureaucracy. When Milsom first arrived in Sydney in March 1824, skilled tradesmen were in hot demand. He was immediately assigned as a stonemason to a government official, Robert Crawford. It was only while preparing for this talk that I realised he must have been working on Crawford's house, Clydebank at Miller's Point. Designed by colonial architect Francis Greenway and completed in 1825, it still stands today. It was not long afterwards that Milsom was convicted of stealing two shirts from the yard of a Mrs. Dibbs. Now, visitors to Hyde Park Barracks will know that convicts received only two shirts per year, and you can imagine the wear and tear they would suffer when worn by a stonewalker. It was this crime that earned him a year at Port Macquarie. After doing his time in Port Macquarie, Milsom returned to Sydney and worked without complaint for the Public Works Department. He was soon promoted to overseer of the government's stonemason gang. The 1828 census shows him resident at Hyde Park Barracks, and it's quite possible that some of the blokes in this motley crew were his roommates. Milsom's transfer to Norfolk Island turns out to be a voluntary decision when he took on the role of overseer of stonemasons there. The remote penal settlement was notoriously harsh and violent, and he no doubt thought it would gain him some brownie points. He returned to Sydney in 1832 with a commendation for a ticket of leave from Major Morisset, then commander on the island, and this was issued in May 1833. Milsom's next appearance in the archives is in November 1837, when he petitioned unsuccessfully for a conditional pardon. I was surprised and delighted to find in his petition a written testimonial from Alexander Macleay, owner of Elizabeth Bay House, which is one of 12 heritage sites now under the care of Sydney Living Museums. It's not uncommon to find Macleay's name in the archives, as he was colonial secretary for 10 years from 1826, but by now he had resigned his position. Macleay's diabolical handwriting reveals that Milsom has been in my employ in building my house at Elizabeth Bay from June 1835 to this time as a stonemason and particularly as a stone setter. I have great satisfaction in recommending him to favourable consideration as a steady tradesman and as a stone setter inferior to none in the colony. I was a guide at Elizabeth Bay House for several years, and while we knew the house was convict built, little is known of the craftsman whose expertise is still evident in what was then the finest house in the colony. Even with Macleay's endorsement and other letters of recommendation from respected citizens, Milsom's application for pardon was rejected on the grounds that he had not held his ticket of leave for the requisite minimum of 6 years. In fact, lifers were often expected to serve 10 years before qualifying. Milsom was advised of this in February 1838. By now, he had a wife, Catherine, a son, George, and another child on the way, Maria. He was living in Parramatta and was working on the construction of the new jail. In May that year, Milsom's ticket of leave was revoked. It was taken from him by the authorities when Milsom was found guilty of assaulting a police constable after an altercation in a local bar. This is how the ticket of leave on display came to be in the state records. Another file in the archive reveals that Milsom's assault charge was reviewed at the request of his employers. An investigation found that the constable had been intoxicated while on duty and had incited the incident. So Milsom's conviction was annulled and a notice was given that his ticket of leave should not at this time be cancelled. And a new ticket was issued. In November 1839, a good 6 years after his original ticket had been issued and 16 years after he was originally sentenced in England, Milsom submitted another petition for conditional pardon. It too includes a newly but equally appallingly written testimonial from Alexander Macleay and other prominent people from Sydney and Parramatta. Macleay nominated him as the best stonemason in the colony, his home at Elizabeth Bay giving ample proof. Milsom was employed from the laying of the foundation until the walls were completed. But the incident with the constable was still a blot on his copybook. The authorities had seen that Milsom's ticket of leave had been revoked after the incident with the constable, but did not notice that the decision had been overturned. The assessor's recommendation was that Milsom must be considered as entirely unworthy of any further indulgence. A note in another hand settles the record and advised that the pardon could be granted, but the application was not signed off for approval until April 1840. Even then, it was not officiated until 1842, more than 2 years since Milsom had submitted his application. The official pardons register lists two people who supported Milsom's application. Alexander Macleay is one, and the other is James Hume, an architect and builder. Who supervised the construction of Elizabeth Bay House and no doubt knew of Milsom's talent. It's thought that Hume also built Burdekin House on Macquarie Street, completed in 1841, Carthona in Darling Point between 1841 and 44, and the York Street Synagogue completed in 1844. It's possible that Milsom went on to work with Hume on these projects, if not others. I'm not an architectural historian, but there's one other architect who played a role in Milsom's career, whom I've not yet mentioned. I got very excited about Milsom's association with Alexander Macleay, but I only realised last week while preparing for this talk that another testimonial in Milsom's first application for a pardon is signed by the acclaimed John Verge. Oh, beg your pardon. This is an image of Burdekin House, and you can see the beautiful stonework there that we can think that Joseph might have been responsible for. John Verge states that Milsom has been known to me for 5 years. The last 3 years of that time has been employed under me at Mr. Macleay's building at Elizabeth Bay, where he's given me satisfaction as a good stone setter and a steady man. Now, it's known that Verge had a hand in the design of Elizabeth Bay House, but to my knowledge, there's little concrete, or should I say sandstone evidence, has been found to date of Verge having an ongoing involvement in the house's construction. This letter, buried in Milsom's petition for pardon since the 1830s, proves it. If Milsom worked for Verge for 5 years, which is pretty much since he received his original ticket of leave in 1833, he may have worked on Burham, now part of Skeggs Darlinghurst, built by Verge in 1833, or Tusculum, which was completed in 1835 and still stands at Potts Point. Milsom's is one of thousands of convict stories from across Australia. His quest for freedom was fraught with hurdles and disappointment, but after almost 20 years of servitude and still in his 30s, he found freedom in the colony. According to ancestry, his wife Catherine died in 1844. Milsom remarried that same year, a widow named Mary Hawkins. Their union enabled Mary to reclaim her daughter from the orphan school, as Milsom agreed to support her. By 1851, Milsom was mining for gold in the Truron at Sofala in New South Wales, and there's a report of him sending 53 ounces of gold to Sydney, so perhaps it was a profitable venture. He died in Sofala the following year. Forming an intimate relationship with Sydney sandstone and later the gold fields of the Truron River, Joseph Milsom constructed a fruitful life on Gadigal, Darug and Wiradjuri country. He progressed from highwayman and shirt stealer to master craftsman, refining his skills as he worked with the who's who of colonial architecture, including Francis Greenway, James Hume and John Verge. His presence in the colony is still with us today, set in stone in some of Sydney's finest buildings.
Thank you, Jackie.
Thank you.
That was absolutely fascinating. Now we've got some questions coming in, or we've had some questions coming in as you've been giving your talk. So let me work through those and we'll see how we go time-wise. I do want to say to everyone though, if your question, we can't get onto your question today, or if this talk really inspires you to ask more questions, we have a special curator inquiry line, and that's askacurator@slm.com.au. First question, Jackie, what's the difference between a stone cutter, stone mason, and stone setter?
I was a bit challenged with this because, as I said, I'm not an architectural historian. From what I can gather, a stone cutter is a person that literally cuts the stone, perhaps not a quarryman, but someone who cuts the stone into usable blocks. A stone mason then takes it to the next point where you select the stone, the right pieces of stone for the right needs, whether that be a wall, a retaining wall, or a foundation or flooring. And then a stone setter has to then, you know, work to make sure that the building is properly finished, that the mortar is correct, that it's all sitting evenly. And of course, we have evidence of that. These buildings have survived for well over 150 years in the colony.
Thank you, Jackie. A question from an audience member, Claire. Jackie, based on your journey of research to discover the life of Joseph Milsom, what tips can you share about researching convicts?
Well, certainly researching out at the State Archives is the best advantage. The staff there are incredibly helpful, but there are convict registers. There's a sort of an online, a lot of information online. There are convict registers and indexes that you can do a bit of homework before you go to the archives to find out if your ancestor or the convict that you are working on, if there are records here in the New South Wales archives. And from then you can contact the Ask an Archivist service who can then, you know, provide you with a bit more information.
Great, thank you. And we've also had one of the very helpful staff at State Archives post on the chat line, which you should all be able to see, a link to some research guides and indexes for undertaking your convict research. Jackie, another question. What a great question. What made Joseph Milsom become a highwayman when he had a trade?
Well, this is his English history is something that I haven't been able to tap into. He was 17 or 18, so perhaps he, got in with the wrong crowd, or perhaps he decided just being, probably a trainee stone cutter at the time. Perhaps it just didn't pay terribly well enough and he had higher aspirations. There are also rumours that people committed crimes on purpose hoping to be sent to Australia. So who knows? We can't tell what his motivation was.
Well, that's a great rumour. Here's a great one from an audience member, Nerida. Jackie, is Macleay's handwriting the worst you have ever encountered? And then how do you go about reading this kind of handwriting?
I've heard from other archivists at State Records, because as I said, Macleay played a very active role in a lot of the record keeping as colonial secretary. And I think it stands out as pretty much one of the most appalling, I think I'll use the word diabolical. I was interested to see in that 2 years between the two letters that he wrote, that his handwriting had actually deteriorated as well. So whether it was because he was in a hurry, I'm not sure, but it really did take some dissecting.
And Jackie, the story of Joseph Milsom is the story of one man out of tens of thousands of men, women and children who were transported to New South Wales. Based on the research that you've done into the archive, and you've delved deep and you've been assisted by some of the wonderful archivists there, Has it inspired you to kind of commit to more research into Joseph Milsom or other characters that you've encountered while researching his story?
Well, I should give a public warning, I suppose. These things can get quite addictive. And as soon as you find one little pearl, you just keep digging and digging for more. And you literally get goosebumps and, you know, you get so excited when you find something that has some resonance for you or that you find these connections across the society of which, you know, Milsom's is a great example of, you know, he touched so many lives in what we think is just, you know, one of thousands of convicts. Of course, they lived in a really burgeoning society. So everybody had contacts with others. And it's really great when they're people that you know from other parts of your own experience.
Thanks, Jackie. We've got a tip from Scott Hill, who says that UK National Archives has a great series of research tips on reading historic handwriting online. So that's something I'll follow up. another question, Jackie. Did you know this about Milsom before commencing your research?
No, I had no idea. I'd never even heard of Joseph Milsom. These objects or items were nominated for the exhibition because it is quite rare to have an original ticket of leave and matching, but that's what makes them so special and why they were chosen for this exhibition. And it was really only once we got these bundles out, these boxes and bundles, that I started realising that there was a lot more to his story. So, yes, it was really truly an adventure of discovery.
And was part of that new discovery the connection with Macleay and Elizabeth Bayhouse? Was that a new discovery?
As far as I know, we had no record that Joseph Milsom had any hand in building that building or any others. So, yes, it was wonderful for me as a curator for Sydney Living Museums to find a place that I had worked in and knew intimately and find that Joseph Milsom obviously had a very intimate connection with that building as well.
We've got time for one more question. Jackie, what was Milsom's connection with Parramatta Jail? How did he get involved?
So as far as I can tell, he was hired as a stonemason by the contractors who won the contract for the jail. And there is some history in the Parramatta Heritage archives about the jail. And, of course, the jail still stands today as the Parramatta Correctional Centre. And it was his employers, Peyton and Hewison, I think, who, you know, stood up for him when he was charged with that assault and obviously heard his side of the story or felt that it was out of character. And so, they really obviously had some faith and confidence in him to ask the police, to the judge, to have another look at the case.
Great, thank you. Sadly, everyone, our time is just about over. So thank you, Jackie Newling, for presenting such an interesting talk, and it was really fascinating in particular to hear that Milsom's work survives today through some of the most iconic colonial buildings in New South Wales. And thank you, our audience, for listening in today from wherever you are in New South Wales or elsewhere in the world. I look forward to seeing you next Thursday at 4 p.m. when Dr. Scott Hill will discuss a most curious archive, a large rusty key found in the records of the Rookwood Asylum for Aged and Infirm Men. If you're enjoying these special History Reflected Behind Closed Doors curator talks, you might also like to join our regular Tuesday lunchtime curator talks. To see what's coming up, please go to the Sydney Living Museum's website, which is www.slm.com.au for the details. Thanks again, Jackie Newling, and thanks again to everyone who's joined us this afternoon. I'm sure you've found the story of Joseph Milsom as fascinating as I have.